We're starting today's session by Professor Vichaka Verma. And yeah, please.
Shall we start?
Okay.
Wait, sir. Good afternoon. Wait, sir. 1 minute, sir. Aliyah was there to start the program, actually.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, Aliyah.
Shall I start?
Yes, yes, Aliyah.
Aristotle has once said, the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, relearn, and unlearn. And I welcome all the dignitaries once again to the second technical session of National Workshop on Scientific Technology, organized by the Department of Economics of Sri College, Sarali, in association with IQSC. Today's technical session concentrates on the topic post-Keynesian economics. The right word in the right place at the right time can soothe, calm, and heal. I invite Lalindar Raji Ramakrishna Ma'am, Assistant Professor of Sri Shankara College, Kalani, for the welcome. I welcome you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Aliyah. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
Okay. A warm good afternoon to one and all present here. It gives me great pleasure to welcome my guru, my motivator, Dr. G. Vichaka Verma, our resource person for today's session, Post-Keynesian Economics. Verma sir has qualified post-graduation in economics from University of Kerala and PhD from University of Mysore. His academical interest doesn't limit to economics alone, but also to psychology, and he did MSc Psychology from Tamil Nadu Open University. Sir retired from service as principal of Panambili Memorial Government College, Chalkudi, and is presently serving as a visiting faculty at MES School of Architecture, Kuttipuram. His book, Economic Approach to Social Interactions, co-authored by Professor Martin Patrick, is being forwarded by the Nobel Prize winner, Professor Gary Becker. And his book, Macroeconomics Simplified, An Introduction to Keynesian and Neoclassical Macroeconomics System, by Sage Publications, is co-authored by Professor Nicole Natras of Cape Town University. Now, on behalf of Economics Department, Sri Shankara College, Kalladi, I would like to welcome Dr. G. Vichaka Verma sir for handling the session. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Gary. Good afternoon to everybody. Respected Principal Sri Shankara College, Kalladi, of the department, Dr. Srija teacher, Dr. Geeta teacher, Dr. Prasad sir, Dr. Premik teacher, Raji Ramakrishnan, other dignitaries, teachers, research colleagues, and dear students. See, I take this opportunity to thank the organizers for giving me this valuable opportunity to speak something about a very broad subject. This subject runs parallel to the mainstream macroeconomics, but unfortunately, this broad alternative macroeconomics has been neglected by most of the universities. But I must say that things were defined in the 1950s and 1960s in India. See, in the early period of our development, our visionary then Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru appointed top eminent economists like Professor V.K.R. Rao, Professor K.N. Raj, Professor Gautam Mathur, and other famous economists, P.C. Mahalanobis, etc., to work under him as a team for the planned economic development of our country. And fortunately, most of these economists were trained at University of Cambridge and University of Oxford. And some of them, they were trained by great teachers like John Maynard Keynes, Robinson, Calvin, and others. And therefore, until the 1970s and up to 1980s, sometime in 1980s, most of the macro syllabus in India and also economic growth and development paper consisted mainly post-Keynesian theories of growth, accumulation, distribution, etc. But unfortunately, after the 1990s, we know that we have started new economic policy from 1991 onwards. And natural, the syllabus settings, they deviated from this great tradition and they brought the mainstream narrow macroeconomics, narrowly focused the macroeconomics in most of the universities. Fortunately, in isolated for example, University, Calcutta University, then Hyderabad, the Central University, then Osmania University, some other universities, and in elite urban centers like JNU, Center for Economic Studies and Planning, this tradition, the old tradition, post-Keynesian tradition, was introduced in the syllabus. For example, in Central for Economic and Social Studies in Charlie, in they had the department, for example, Krishna Bhardwaj in JNU. And they energy took steps to rise the ideas of this great post-Keynesian economist. Now, you look at the cartoon in the slide here, in the screen, and you can see a grandmother teaching one of her grandchildren. Now, what is her suggestion? Pick out any model you want. And the child, broad-minded, maybe he may be a very enthusiastic, he selects a heterodox model. And immediately the grandmother scolds him and say that, no, you can't have that one. That is a heterodox model. Now, students with an inquisitive mind, they want broad spectrum of approaches. But what is happening? The syllabus driving boards of universities, syllabus centers, they shut to them and they instead the mainstream macro model. Now, what is the nature of macroeconomics taught in the graduate and undergraduate level, at the graduate and undergraduate level in the most of the universities? See, we begin with a charter or national income. Then we move to consumption, then investment, then C and I, and we will get the aggregate demand function. Then combining with the 45 degree aggregate supply, we find the equilibrium level of income. Since ideas, original ideas are different from what we study as Keynesian economics, Professor Paul Samuelson published a popular textbook titled Economics, 1948. And in 1940, in order to popularize the ideas of, he invented a method. It is called the Keynesian Rose Analysis, the C plus I curve, then the aggregate supply curve, equilibrium, level of income, etc., etc. Now I have the next edition. I got this from an old book, and you can see the diagram there. In the cover page itself, the equilibrium between investment and saving is created. Now, this kind of created by Samuel, and this is what is known as the hydrochronic Keynes. For example, in one page, he explains the entire Keynesian system in the form of a hydraulic picture. And therefore, Samuelson Keynesian theory by using a framework. This is one of the most important criticism raised against the mainstream Keynesian model by the post-Keynesians. Samuelson called his approach as neoclassical synthesis. Why? Because he was trying to impress upon us that in the short run, Keynesian argument, downward inflexibility of wages and prices will hold true, but the economy will go back to full employment. Now, this approach is a compromise. Why? Because it was supported by some of the early Keynesians like Hicks, Hansen, and others. And it was acceptable to the supporters of the classical. See, Keynesian system. Another major development that took place after the publication of general theory, it was ISLM model. And we know that it was invented by Professor Jiang, and later it was elaborated by Hansen. Again, approach also equilibrium and she combined the class arguments. We say that the equilibrium in combining the audible to?
Not clear, sir.
It's you are audible, but I think there is some problem in connection.
What about now?
Now, okay.
So, income expenditure model. Keynesian cross analysis was one concrete explanation of Keynesian theory. And following the economy, orthodox Keynesian economists, they are called as orthodox Keynesian economists, they elaborated Keynesian theory in a similar manner by using a classical Valrasian framework. Franco Modigliani, Lawrence Klein and Rich. Now, you practice the form Indian universities. To represent the post-Keynesian development, usually we use the short form post-Keynesian to cover all developments after the publication of general theory. See, post-Keynesian, the name, a formal name which we use to represent all developments after the publication of general theory in macroeconomics. But I must say that this same post-Keynesianism is applicable to only a distinct school of thought, distinct macroeconomic school of thought, and established by mainly by students and colleagues of John Maynard Keynes, and they are called as the Cambridge Sisters. And macroeconomics was founded originally close associated associates of John Maynard Keynes. Now, post-Keynesian a different approach, and their approach encompasses a broad spectrum of and there are within the post-Keynesian group there are several branches, alternative branches or groups. Look at the slide, you can see some important aspects of the post-Keynesian heterodox school. These points as introduction. The post-Keynesian school integrates a broad spectrum of themes. For example, Keynes gives the monetary perspective of their approach, liquidity, preference, etc., etc., speculative demand, etc. Michael Kalaski's real analysis provides the explanations for the capitalist development. Piero Straffa and other Anglo-Italian economists, they have extended value and capital, value, capital and distribution theories. only a lecturer, not a professor. And they focus their attention on the real side of the economy. Reject neoclassical marginalism and they employ classical surplus theoretic approach. Yesterday, Dr. Alex Thomas, sir, he explained all this in detail. So these economies, they use the classical surplus theoretical approach. Now, just you compare their approach with the mainstream approach you study in the macroeconomics paper in the classrooms. See, at present, when we study macroeconomics, we will not refer to economic classes in a society. We live in a class-based society. But mainstream macroeconomics, whether it is mainstream Keynesianism of Gregory Mankiw and all other prominent economists, Samuelson, Hicks, and others, or if you examine the macro theories of the classical supporters like the new classical Lucas, Argent, Milton Friedman, and others, you can see that there is complete absence of a class structure. Similarly, mainstream macroeconomics does not give importance to the share of profits and share of wages or the role of income distribution in the economy. Is it not so? നിങ്ങൾ എല്ലാം പഠിക്കുന്ന മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് ക്ലാസ് റൂമിൽ പഠിക്കുന്ന മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് പരിശോധിക്കും. മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീം തിയറീസ് യു സ്റ്റഡി ദയർ ഡസ് നോട്ട് ഗിവ് എനി ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസ്, ഡസ് നോട്ട് ഈവൻ മെൻഷൻ അബൌട്ട് ദി ഷെയർ ഓഫ് വേജസ് ആൻഡ് ഷെയർ ഇൻ ദി ആൻഡ് ദേ ഡു നോട്ട് യൂസ് They do not use a class structure. They do not like even mentioning about the income distribution. For example, in consumption function theory hypothesis, you have to study, fortunately, Duesenberry's hypothesis. But if you examine modern textbooks, you can't see the relative income hypothesis. You can see only permanent income hypothesis. And Modigliani's life cycle hypothesis. You will not be able to find Duesenberry's relative income hypothesis in Gregory Mankiw's book or any other mainstream. Why? Because the mainstream economists, whether they belong Orthodox Keynesian school, who have accepted equilibrium explanation of Keynes, or the classical supporters, new classical, etc., they dislike speaking about income distribution in the economy. They believe in Pareto optimality, but they won't say anything about income distribution. And Duesenberry explains pattern of consumption, relative consumption, in terms of position of an individual in the income distribution. So Mankiw and others, they discard the important, very, very important work by Duesenberry. Now, the first line of a thought represented by Professors Joanne Robinson, Nicholas Kaldor, and others, they have three major characteristics in their approach. You look at these slides. They focus on three major points or three major characteristics. These characteristics are important. If you want to understand post-Keynesian macroeconomic fundamental aspects, you must be familiar with these three points. What is the first one? It is given in point A. Price effects play a subordinate role in the economy. They discard price effect. Post-Keynesian, these original post-Keynesians, they discard price effects, the role of price effects. Now, what is the implication? In other words, we can say that they discard price flexibility argument of the classical supporters, neoclassic supporters of the neoclassical economists. And they say that employment following their leader, John, they say that employment is a function of aggregate demand. It is exclusive function of the aggregate demand. All N is a function of AD, aggregate demand. And what is the difference between this specification and the specification in the mainstream neoclassical model? In the mainstream neoclassical model, and even in the long-run extensions of mainstream Keynesian models by orthodox economists and new Keynesian economists, you can say employment is a function of real wage. They define employment as a function of the real wage. So what happens? By allowing flexibility to the real wage, level of employment can be adjusted. But the post-Keynesians, they discard. Now the first group of post-Keynesians, they are called as fundamentalist Keynesians. Fundamentalist Keynesians. And they are the close, so they were the close associates and students of Maynard Keynes. They were taught by Maynard Keynes, belonging to the Cambridge Circus. They say that employment is the exclusive function of aggregate demand, and it is not at all a function of the real wage, and thereby they discard the possibility for price flexibility and the creation of full employment. That is the first major point, characteristic feature. Second is given in point B. What is it? Point B states that economic process is not, they explore economic process not by using a static Walrasian allocation model or by using a solo type model where economic growth is supposed to exist. Sorry, economic growth is analyzed by saying that full employment is already there. So they discard the Walrasian equilibrium apparatus. Similarly, they also discard the solo type economic growth explanation, which assumes that full employment, the economy has already reached the full employment, existence of full employment, and the existence of only voluntary unemployment. That is also discarded. Again, let me deviate from the main point. You verify any modern textbook in macroeconomics. Modern means modern mainstream, not okay. Modern mainstream book in macroeconomics. See, after nationalism explanation in the introductory chapter, whether it is Markey or any other Bernanke or any other Keynesian or new classical economist, he or she will directly go to solo growth model. And the next chapter completely explains growth. Then only towards the end of the book, they will come to the question of components of aggregate demand like consumption and investment. But post-Keynesians discard this kind of a methodology from their books. They directly deal with aggregate demand and aggregate supply analysis, aggregate demand analysis. For example, I have a Xeroxed copy of Victoria Chick's book, After General Theory, titled After General Theory. In that book, she gives a detailed explanation of the microeconomics behind aggregate demand and the labor market. So this is the second major characteristic feature of the first line of thought within the post-Keynesian school. Now look at the third aspect given in C. Income distribution, previous slide. Income distribution is intimately connected with economic growth. And strategic variables of analysis are profit share and investment activity. Economic growth depends upon the relative share of profits in the national income. Fortunately, universities in our state, whether it is Kerala, Gandhi, Calicut, or Kannur University, students, they had to study macro theories of distribution. We include it in microeconomics. But those theories explain the share of wages, share of profits, etc. in the economy and its relation to economic growth. The representative model, Keynesian model, has been developed by Professor Nicholas Carr. You all study, you students, study that model in detail. So the third characteristic of the first line of thought within the early post-Keynesians is regarding income distribution and economic growth and their connection. By stressing that economic growth very much depends upon the strategic variables, number one, share of profit in the economy, and number two, the volume of investment in the economy. Now, this completes explanation regarding the first line of thought within the post-Keynesian school. Now, let us come to the second line of thought. There are several lines of thought, but we are focusing only the two principal lines of thought one can see within the post-Keynesian microeconomics. Second line of thought is given in the fourth slide. Next slide. The second line of approach was led by economists like Professor G.L.S. Shackle is a very innovative economist. Unfortunately, the mainstream textbooks, they ignore his name. Not only his name, many prominent economists who have introduced the innovative heterodox ideas, their names you can't see in the mainstream textbooks like that of Mackey. Second line of argument led by Proces, G.L.S. Shackle, Hyman Minsky. And this line of argument can be put the title Money and Uncertainty. A prominent modern post-Keynesian, I cannot say that I can't call him as modern because he is 90 years of old. Now he is 90 years of old and he is a very active and he is an American post-Keynesian. Now Hyman Minsky and Paul Davidson, they are American Keynesians. Similarly, Sidney Lindtrap, another very, very important name in the early post. So Paul Davidson, G.L.S. Shackle and Hyman Minsky, they are line of thought. Can be put under the title Money and Uncertainty because they have elaborated arguments of John Maynard Keynes with regard to the role of money, similarly the role of uncertainty in capitalist, mature capitalist economy. Economists assign great importance to monetary disturbances and they regard neoclassical equilibrium analysis as irrelevant. Neoclassical analysis, mainstream analysis, neoclassical analysis, as well as the neoclassical explanations of Keynesian, Hicks, Hanson, Modigliani, Tobin, and similarly the new Keynesians, Grigory, Mackey, Akerlof, and all of this. Akerlof recently deviated to a different line of approach. Anyway, these economists, they have not understood the definition of uncertainty given by J.M. Keynes in Gel Theory. They have not able to any GBT arguments of John Maynard Keynes in general theory on uncertainty and contribution. Now, you know what kind of a man was John Maynard Keynes? Very tall, was She was versed in mathematics. It is graduation in mathematics, the first class or first rank. Then he opted for economics. He prepared for Indian civil service exam, IAS examination. And he was taught by Marshall. So he got interested in economics. And he came to economics. He was under the influence of Marshall when he wrote the tract on monetary. But later he deviated with the publication of his treatise on money. And finally, in general theory, he revolted against the classical theory. He was a great intellectual. He was the student of Eton School, then Cambridge, University of Cambridge. He was taught by Marshall, Pigou, and others. But he was influenced by a group of intellectuals, study group. It included economists, mathematics, and artists like philosophers like Lytton Strachey, novelists like E.M. Forster and Virginia Woolf. So it was a group of intellectuals. So John Maynard Keynes was an economist, mathematician, and a great intellectual. Was art paintings, great paintings of impressionist painters of the 19th century. So he was a collector of books. He was a statesman. The creation of IMF and IBM. He was a when compared to mathematics, engineer, economist. And even Raghuram Rajan econometrics. But when you compare this mathematical economist, you can see that must add one more both patients, they have their own econometric modeling and there are books. And it is different from mainstream economics, from Keynesian econometrics. Now, this is the second line of argument. Now, next slide. Now, let us examine who were the first post-Keynesians. Who are the founders of the post-Keynesian school? According to a post-Keynesian economist, current post-Keynesian economist named J.E., he published a book titled History of Post-Keynesian Macroeconomics, a very useful book, and free downloading you can do in the Google, with the help of a Google search. And in this book, he says that Professors Joan Robinson, Nicholas Calder, Hugh Townshend, that name is not popular, Hugh Townshend. These three could be called as the first post-Keynesians. And we can add Richard Kahn. See, you may be knowing Kahn's name because Keynes used the concept of multiplier from the concept of employment multiplier developed by Richard Kahn. Then Brian Rundavi. Rundavi's book was popular while we were students, PG students, because his book on Indian planning was recommended in our planning paper. W.B. Rundavi, then Rory Harrod, then Piero Saffo, all these economists' names can be added to Robinson, Calder, and Hugh Townshend. Now, majority of these economists, especially the first three and Richard Kahn, they were members of the Cambridge Circus, a group called as Cambridge Circus, who were the immediate students and followers and co-workers of Maynard Keynes. So they knew John Maynard Keynes very well. They had evening conversations in coffee shops with John Maynard Keynes. See, teacher, he was only a lecturer, but in the evening, after the classes, he will join with his students, Professor Robinson, Calder, and others, and engage in conversation. conditions. See, look at the social life then and now. So much interaction between students and teachers. Now, Michael Kalki's name from outside this circle will fill the first early post-grad issues. Side by side, we must add Sidney Weintraub, he was a very promising economist, U.S. economist, who gave a thorough microeconomic theory to Keynesian aggregate demand, aggregate supply framework. Now, Keynesian aggregate supply and demand, they are different from Samuelson's aggregate demand and supply. Samuelson uses his own invention, C+I curve and aggregate straight line aggregate supply curve. But Keynes did not use this diagram. He used only a single diagram in the general theory, that is the diagram of employment determination, principle of effective demand, using the upward sloping aggregate supply price curve and downward sloping, see, the curve, aggregate demand curve. That is also the only diagram used by Keynes in general theory. Now, Weintraub gave a micro foundation to the principle of effective demand, or the original diagrammatic representation by Keynes. Now, they worked in USA to popularize the post-Keynesian theory. So, next slide. Theory contributions you can see from the works of early Keynesians. But I will, because of time limitation, I will concentrate only the one major contribution of Professor Robinson. Professor Robinson has contributed in many areas. You know that she is a person who developed in microeconomics imperfect information theory. Is it not so? Imperfect information, imperfect competition theory. She is the author of imperfect competition theory. Later, or at the same time, Professor Chamberlain developed the monopolistic competition theory. Then in macroeconomics, she extended Keynesian theory. She reformulated and extended Keynesian theory without losing the originality of her general theory. Now, one of her early book was titled as Essays in the Theory of Employment. Again, you can download this book. Free downloading is possible. Essays in the Theory of Employment. And this book can be considered as the very first post-Keynesian macroeconomic textbook. Very first post-Keynesian macroeconomic textbook. Fitting to the labor market, she emphasized or she developed a wage push theory of inflation, and she discarded quantity theory of money, explanation of inflation. Discarded the quantity theory of money, explanation, type explanation of inflation. And instead explained inflation by using the argument of wage augmenting situations. And according to her argument, money wage is a function, level of money wage is a function in the economy. It is a function of the relative bargaining power of unions and employees. It depends upon money wage. What determines money wage in an economy? Money wage in an economy, according to her argument, depends upon the bargaining power of the trade unions and the employees. Now, the same thing happens in India, in Kerala, is not so. Where trade union monopoly is there. And unions, they always demand a higher wage. They stand for increase in wages. On the other side, Employees, they always stand for a reduction. They will pressurize for a reduction in the money wage. Suppose that union organization is constant, strength of the union is the same. Then a change or increase in money wage becomes the exclusive function of the fluctuations in the demand in the economy. You look at the argument of Professor Robinson. If the relative strength of unions and employees are constant, then changes in the money wage in the economy becomes the exclusive function of fluctuations in effective demand. And what are the implications? Unions determine the money wage. Money wage determines the price level, aggregate price level. And given the money supply by the central bank, another point I must add here. This is a very, very early theory propounded by Professor Robinson as a condition at Rudolph School. Later, exogenous theory. And they have introduced what is known as endogenous. Come to that point later. So, when unions are powerful, then they will bargain for a higher wage rate. And vice versa. Given the money supply, we can say that price level is determined by the rate of interest. So unions determine the money wage determines the aggregate price level given the money supply determine the interest rate. Now, let me ask a question to postgraduate students. Price level koodumbol, enganeyaana rate of interest varum? ഇത് പോസ്റ്റ് ഗ്രാജുവേറ്റ് സ്റ്റുഡൻസിനോടുള്ള ഒരു ചോദ്യമാണ്. ഒരു സമ്പദ് വ്യവസ്ഥയിലെ ആഗ്രിഗേറ്റ് പ്രൈസ് ലെവൽ വർദ്ധിക്കുമ്പോൾ പ്രൈസ് ആഗ്രിഗേറ്റ് പ്രൈസ് ലെവൽ വർദ്ധിക്കുമ്പോൾ പലിശ നിരക്കുകൾ എങ്ങനെയാണ്? Now in order to understand that you must examine the equilibrium between supply of money and demand for money there. Supply of money in the traditional model is a constant exogenously given. Demand for money you can divide into three. What are they? Transaction demand, speculative demand, and precautionary demand. We can add a transaction demand and precautionary demand into a single unit because both are the functions of level of income, isn't it? Level of income. While according to Keynes, the speculative demand is a function of the rate of interest and uncertainty, uncertain situation. Now, when price increases, what will happen? The limitation of an online class. In a classroom, the blackboard and chalk piece, I would have been more comfortable. I could have textbooks, you will not get this diagram. If price level increases, transaction demand for money will rise. Hello? Price level varthikkumbol, transaction demand for money varthikkum. About total supply curve of money, transaction precautionary demand in vendi ulla supply money supply varthikkum. Total money supply for money supply left leg shifting. Supply of money exclusively for speculative purposes will shift leftwards. So given the liquidity preference curve, a leftward shift in the speculative demand for money supply will lead to a rise in the rate of interest. And this will depress the level of investment and it will reduce the effective demand through reverse multiplier operation, and there will be unemployment. So in this manner, beautifully, she explains how the employment depends upon effective demand. What is the relation between employment, level of employment, money wage rate, level of employment, effective demand, etc., etc. Now, next slide. Next slide, slide 7. Now, let us quickly go through other major theories propounded by early post-Keynesians. Early post-Keynesians means those were post-Keynesians until 1970s, until the end of 1970s, from the 1940s onwards, after the publication of general theory onwards. Number one, macro-Keynesian theory of distribution of power. Now, I should not explain it in detail. I must mention only the name because you study it in your PG class, microeconomics. Macro theories of distribution. Representative Keynesian model has been developed by Professor Nicholas Calvo. Then Michael Kaluski, yesterday Professor Alex Thomas R, he explained the importance of Kaluskian economics. Now, Kaluski's degree of monopoly theory of pricing. He has developed a micro theory of pricing, markup theory, degree of monopoly theory. Markup plays a very important role in that model. Previously in MG University for PG, this theory was recommended in macroeconomics. Then Robinson's eclectic theory, in which he used the neoclassical concept of elasticity of substitution. You know that it was a concept developed by Professor Hicks in his book, first book named The Theory of Wages. Professor Hicks published this book while he was in his 20s. His first book, he developed the concept of elasticity of substitution, which is widely used by the neoclassical economists. For example, in Cobb-Douglas production function, etc., elasticity of substitution. CES, production function, you study in microeconomics, constant elasticity, substitution, production function. So, Robinson, she used a neoclassical type elasticity of substitution, but she used it only as apparatus to explain the distribution of product between profits and wages. She borrowed this concept, but she explained by using this concept, the most important theme in the post-Keynesian macroeconomics, that is distribution of national product into profits and wages. So her theory is called as eclectic theory. Then next is the contribution made by another Frank Hann, he is a prominent person in the mainstream theory. He developed general equilibrium, etc. But his PhD work was a Pakka thesis in post-Keynesian type theory because he was a student of the University of Cambridge. So Frank Hann's PhD work at Cambridge. Then post-Keynesian theories of the determination of markup by followers of Kaluski like Alfred Eisner, Adrian Woods, James Ball, Geoff Harcourt. Again, Harcourt is a prominent name. His book also can be downloaded from the Google. Then macroeconomic theories of accumulation, contributed by Abba Lerner. Now, Lerner was a student of Keynes and a colleague of Robinson, Caldor, Kahn, and others. Lerner's name you know because in public finance you study his theory of functional finance. So, Lerner, then in international trade also you study Marshall-Lerner condition. Kaluski, Robinson, Now, there is a very, very interesting diagram introduced by Robinson explaining the process of accumulation and the role of animal spirits in the corn. You might have heard about the name of animal spirits. And you might have heard about the famous quotation from Keynes. He has stated about the animal spirits, the spontaneous urge to for action rather than inaction. I suddenly forgot the complete definition. And among the investors, he was named as animal spirits by Keynes. Now Keynes used the several psychological concepts. And in a book I saw that for his ICS examination, psychology also has a percentage. And he studied some psychological theories, and he was fascinated by some psychological theories. That is why he brought some psychological concept in his journal. And one such concept is the concept of animal spirits. And Professor Robinson, while developing her model of accumulation, she has developed a fascinating diagram called the banana diagram. B-A-N-A-N-A, banana diagram, very famous diagram. Now I shall show you the diagram. Now, I do not know whether you can see this diagram. Banana, it will look like a banana. Unfortunately, no mainstream textbook even mentioned her name. Namarella Varchi Urino Edu macroeconomics are Gandhi Vashantan Kanda Muri Kirti Kudragale Pura Namala macroeconomics lake in Aichuga Namal Varikan macroeconomics the parallel Iuru Samudra Dane Unda Malaridilla Adunda Namala Robinson. So this banana diagram is a famous one. Interesting, very interesting diagram. And through this diagram, Robinson explained the macroeconomic aspects of accumulation. She developed a model of accumulation. And she published a probe in a very, very complex book named Accumulation Capital. So a number of her theories are there. Then the Safa's system of value and distribution theory. Yesterday, Professor Alexa, he mentioned about the book published by, famous book published by Smallwood, using similar equation. Mathematical equations, measurement of capital, Cambridge controversy. Regarding measurement of capital, may economics considered as a concrete thing. Economics marginal product, concept of total factor productivity, capital marginal product measure. And the war plane, capital, a collection of items. So how will you find out the marginal product? Discard the concept of measurement of capital for a measurement. Capital, a single capital. University and NG University capital controversy. Student Darko State prizes and distribution and Moki Prendis all published the book of Gal. Students in a ECI Manslav. Question would be difficult angle number. Professor William J. Barmold, Economic Theory and Operations Analysis of the Catholic University, whatever detailed item. So, major aspects of those conditions. Now, we will come to my second part of explanation. Next slide, next part. Any difficulty in hearing me? Hello.
Hello, sir.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but there is some problem. I think there is some problem in your voice. It's breaking at some places.
Now, see, I have completed the first part of my presentation. The other two parts, I will quickly cover and answer your question. Can you hear me now? Hello? Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. I can hear you.
So I must change my seat. 1 minute, please. I hope now you can hear me. Now, next slide, next part, please. Next part, please. Hello? Hello?
Sir, yes, sir.
Kekka, sir, you
know? No, sir, Kekka.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Next slide, Rajesh.
Okay, post-Keynesian.
Part two. Slide.
Presentation two or lesser?
Part two. Slide. Core principles.
വിസിബിൾ അല്ലേ സർ, ഞാനിപ്പോ അതന്നെയാണ് ഷെയർ ചെയ്തിരിക്കുന്നത്.
എനിക്ക് വിസിബിൾ അല്ല. ഐ കാൻ സീ. I shall read it. I hope all of us can see this slide.
Yes, sir, we can see it.
I can't see, but anyway, I shall, without wasting time, I shall go through this slide. Whenever I want to change this slide, I will request Raj. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Now look at the first slide. The core principles of post-Keynesian macroeconomics are given. Professor Tony Thirlwall, he has summarized the core principles of post-Keynesian macroeconomics into 6 major points. Thirlwall's name is popular because he studied his textbook in economics of development. Development economics. Now, according to him, the first major point with regard to post-Keynesian core principle regarding employment and unemployment. And he says that employment and unemployment in the post-Keynesian theory are determined in the product market and not in the labor market. Unemployment, extent of unemployment in an economy, it is determined by the in the product market and not in the labor market. Compare this argument with the argument in the classical model. In the classical model, is initially in the labor market, corresponding to full employment, and then an output level corresponding to this full employment will be in the product market. Classical theory, labor market il ninnu product market lekkana sequence. Labor market il aggregate supply of labor, demand for labor equilibrium aagunnathu full employment undaagunu. അതിനെ തുടർന്ന് അതിന് തുല്യമായ ഔട്ട്പുട്ട് പ്രോഡക്റ്റ് മാർക്കറ്റിൽ നിശ്ചയിക്കപ്പെടുന്നു. ഇതാണ് സീക്വൻസ്. പ്രോഡക്റ്റ് മാർക്കറ്റ് വ്യത്യാസം നിങ്ങൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കുക. ഇഫക്റ്റീവ് ഡിമാൻഡ് ഡിറ്റർമിൻസ് എംപ്ലോയ്മെന്റ് ആൻഡ് ഔട്ട്പുട്ട്, ആൻഡ് ദിസ് ഔട്ട്പുട്ട് ഡിറ്റർമിൻസ് ദി വോളിയം ഓഫ് എംപ്ലോയ്മെന്റ്. ഇഫക്റ്റീവ് ഡിമാൻഡ് ഡിറ്റർമിൻസ് ദി വോളിയം ഓഫ് ഔട്ട്പുട്ട്, and this volume of output determines the equilibrium employment. It determines the equilibrium employment. And that is the first point. Second point, involuntary unemployment is due to effective demand failure and not due to labor market imperfections. In the classical model, there is only voluntary unemployment. And voluntary employment will take place because of imperfections in the labor. But in the Keynesian theory, involuntary unemployment is involuntary unemployment. This involuntary unemployment, it is due to effective demand, and it is not due to market imperfections. Third point. Causation runs from investment to savings. Keynesian theory, investment il ninnu aanu saving ilekku nayikkunnu. Saving il ninnu investment ilekkalla sequence. Investment creates income and a part of income will be consumed, the remainder will be saved. So the sequence will be from investment to saving. Then the fourth point, fourth core principle. Keynesian theory deals with a money economy. Therefore, money is non-neutral. Now, compare it with the classical situation. In the classical model, they deal with a barter
type Valrasian economy, barter economy, where any commodity can assume the role of money. And that is why Professor Clover, in his important article, said money buys goods and goods buy money, but money, goods do not buy goods. Now, next point, number six, quantity theory of money is misleading. Quantity theory of money is misleading. Why? Because of four major reasons. Because number one, money is endogenous. Money supply is endogenous. Endogenous means, in the mainstream Keynesian and classical model, money supply is determined by the central bank. And central bank is an external institution, external to the market forces or price mechanism. But in the Keynesian model, in the post-Keynesian model, money supply is treated as endogenous. Money supply accommodates the production decisions by the entrepreneurs. So the causality in MV is equal to PT equation. In the equation, famous quantity theory equation, MV is equal to PT, the causality is from right to left and not from left to right. Fisher in the quantity equation, like classical theory, classical monetary theory, causation is from MV to PT. But in post-Keynesian monetary theory, the causation is from PT to MV. PT to MV. Then next, changes in liquidity preference leads to changes in velocity of circulation. Any change in liquidity preference of the people will lead to change in the velocity of circulation. Then next, cost push factors generate inflation before full employment. I have illustrated it with the Professor Robinson's model earlier. Then next point, capitalist economies are driven by animal spirits and investors. Animal spirits influences investors' investment decision. Again, this point also I covered earlier. So these are the core principles according to Professor Tony Thevar, core principles of post-Keynesian macroeconomics. Then slide two, please. Look at this slide. You can see the title, implications of the core principles. What are the implications of these principles? Post-Keynesian macroeconomics. Number one, Say's law is false. Say's law, post-Keynesians reject, just like their leader Keynes, they reject the operation of Say's law. Employment and output are demand constrained and not supply constrained. Say's law, pravartikamallengil, പിന്നെ എന്താണ് സംഭവിക്കുന്നത്? സെയിൽസ് ലോ, ഇഫ് സെയിൽസ് ലോ ഈസ് നോട്ട് ഓപ്പറേറ്റീവ്, ദെൻ ഔട്ട്പുട്ട് ആൻഡ് എംപ്ലോയ്മെന്റ് ദേ ആർ ഡിമാൻഡ് കൺസ്ട്രെയിൻഡ് ആൻഡ് നോട്ട് സപ്ലൈ കൺസ്ട്രെയിൻഡ്. ആൻഡ് നെക്സ്റ്റ്, ദെർഫോർ മെയിൻ്റെനൻസ് ഓഫ് ഫുൾ എംപ്ലോയ്മെന്റ് റിക്വയേഴ്സ് സ്റ്റേറ്റ് ഇന്റർവെൻഷൻ, ആക്റ്റീവ് സ്റ്റേറ്റ് ഇന്റർവെൻഷൻ. Then next, fiscal policy is effective and the principle of Ricardian equivalence is false. Now, this argument was put forward by the modern post-Keynesians, not early post-Keynesians, because Robert Barrow, the new classical macroeconomist, introduced the Ricardian equivalence during the 80s. Modern post-Keynesians, they reject the Ricardian equivalence. എന്താണ് റിക്കാർഡിയൻ ഇക്വാലൻസ് എന്ന് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് പി ജി സ്റ്റുഡൻസിന് അറിയാം. അതിന്റെ ഡീറ്റെയിൽസിലേക്ക് ഞാൻ പോകുന്നില്ല. In order to save, then prices and output policies are needed to control inflation. Then lastly, principle of effective demand is the basis. Ellathinteyum adisthanam principle of effective demand aagunnu. Now let us consider post-Keynesian approach, slide 3. Post-Keynesian approach, slide 3.
Yes, sir.
See, you can, below the title, you can see number 1. Post-Keynesians, they have generalized the general theory, generalization of the general theory. Second, expectation and uncertainty are two most important aspects Keynes gave importance. So they have elaborated expectation and uncertainty arguments of Keynes. Number 3, they extended Keynes' vision to economic growth, accumulation, distribution, and they have accounted inherent financial instability. Then Harrod and Omer, they provided the dynamic growth theory by extending Keynesian short-run analysis to long-run dynamics of growth. Then, as I said earlier, repetition thaniyana, Robinson accumulation of capital. Then Kaldor distribution theory, Minsky financial instability theory, Kalski capitalist dynamics, and Straffa value theory. Now, next slide number 4. Slide number 4.
Okay, sir.
See, what is the methodology used by the post-Keynesian macroeconomists? We need to analyze this question. What is the difference in the methodology of post-Keynesians and the mainstream economists? Number 1, the mainstream economists, neoclassical and new classical economists, they use logical time analysis, while post-Keynesians, they use historical time analysis. The mainstream economists, they use logical time analysis and they examine existence of equilibrium and its uniqueness. And they do not depend upon time, but time is in the background. But post-Keynesians, they reject this methodology. They introduce the historical time analysis. And there is a famous quotation by Professor Robinson that is given there. Today is an ever-widening gap between a known past and unknown future, a famous quotation from Joan Robinson. She has published an article titled "History versus Theory." നേരത്തെ ഇത് ഉൾപ്പെടുത്തിയിട്ടുള്ള ചാപ്റ്ററാണ്, ഒരു ആർട്ടിക്കിൾ ആണ്, ഹിസ്റ്ററി വേഴ്സസ് ഇക്വിലിബ്രിയം. ഇൻ ദിസ് ആർട്ടിക്കിൾ ഷീ ഡിസ്റ്റിംഗ്വിഷസ് ബിറ്റ്വീൻ ഹിസ്റ്റോറിക്കൽ ടൈം ആൻഡ് ലോജിക്കൽ. പാസ്റ്റ് ഈസ് എംബോഡിഡ് ഇൻ ദി കറന്റ് സിറ്റുവേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ലിമിറ്റ്സ് ദി റേഞ്ച് ഓഫ് ആക്ഷൻസ് ദാറ്റ് ക്യാൻ ബി ഡൺ. And capital, therefore, is heterogeneous, and time is irreversible. That is their argument. Time is irreversible, and future is unknowable. And probability theory cannot be used to measure uncertainty or to measure the events in the future. Next slide, please.
Yes, sir.
Now, in the next slide, you can see the difference between some important aspects with regard to methodology in the post-Keynesian school and in the new Keynesian school. Sorry, post-Keynesian school and in the mainstream school. With regard to different economic variables, directionality of time, reversibility with regard to directionality of time, reversibility is assumed by the mainstream economies in logical time analysis. Irreversibility is assumed by the historical time analysis. Then time intensity or action, instantaneous adjustment in logical time and discreteness in historical time. Then expectations, perfect foresight and self-realizing economy in logical time, falsifiable in historical time analysis because future is unknowable. Information is assumed symmetric in logical time analysis, but local learning and costly in historical time analysis. Then capital goods, substitutability, logical time, but specificity or lumpiness in historical time. Investment, elastic in liquidity in logical time. Investment inertia is assumed, driven by animal spirits in historical time. Technical change is disembodied in logical time analysis. It is embodied and path dependent in historical time analysis. Then money, with regard to money and finance, barter economy and passive money in logical, but active money and incomplete markets in historical time analysis. So these are the differences in the with regard to economic values. Now next slide, that is slide number
6. Yes, sir.
Yes, slide number 6. 1 minute, please. A diagrammatic explanation showing the difference between logical time analysis and historical time methodology is given in the picture. ഈ രണ്ട് മെത്തഡോളജിയുടെയും വ്യത്യാസത്തിനെയാണ് ഈ ഡയഗ്രത്തിൽ കാണിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നത്. And as an illustration, we select a topic from microeconomics, derivation of the long run supply curve. അതിന്റെ സമയക്കുറവ് കാരണം അതിന്റെ പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട ഡിഫറൻസ് മാത്രമേ ഞാൻ പറയുന്നുള്ളൂ. Now consider the points ABD. ABD represents the virtual long run supply curve in the neoclassical microeconomic theory. Now what is its nature? It is a smooth curve and movements onward and backward in a backward direction both are possible. Mumbottum purakottum ore pole sanjarikkavunna ഒരു സ്മൂത്ത് കർവ് ആണ് ലോങ് റൺ സപ്ലൈ കർവ് ന്യൂ ക്ലാസിക്കൽ മാക്രോ തിയറിയിലും അതേപോലെ തന്നെ ഓൾഡ് ക്ലാസിക്കൽ മാക്രോ തിയറിയിലും ഉള്ളത്. ബട്ട് ഇൻ പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ മാക്രോ തിയറി ലോങ് റൺ സപ്ലൈ കർവ് ഈസ് പാത്ത് ഡിപ്പെൻഡൻസ്, ഇറിവേഴ്സിബിൾ പാത്ത് ഡിപ്പെൻഡൻസ്. ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ എ ഡാഷ്, ബിക്കോസ് ഓഫ് ദി ഡിസ്ക്രീറ്റ്നെസ് ഓഫ് ക്യാപിറ്റൽ, the long run supply curve becomes incomplete or discontinuous and the sequence a dash b c b dash d represents the long run supply curve in post keynesian microeconomic theory. Post keynesian macroeconomic theory ulla pole post keynesian microeconomic theory undu. Innale oru student adine sambandhiche oru question chodichirunnu. Now these are the things I must say with regard to the second part. Now we shall move to the third part, the winding up part. Please, part 3.
Okay sir, wait a minute.
ഈ പാർട്ട് 3-ൽ കൂടി ഞാൻ പെട്ടെന്ന് സ്പീഡിൽ പോകാം. Now three post Keynesian views are explained in the slides. There are several viewpoints and explanations, but for your convenience I have selected only three. Moona pradhanapetta viewpoints maatrame ivide select cheyidittullu. Now the first yes, I can see now.
Okay,
I can see the slide now.
Okay sir.
Post-Keynesian views, a selection from the many branches of post-Keynesian school. Slide number 1, please. First major view is the fundamentalist Keynesian view. A group of post-Keynesians, they are called as fundamentalist Keynesians. early Keynesians, early post-Keynesians. They are known as the fundamentalist Keynesians. Who is a fundamentalist? നിങ്ങൾ വളരെ ഒരു വിപ്ലവകാരിയാണ്, എപ്പോഴും വിപ്ലവം പറയുന്നു. പക്ഷെ നിങ്ങളുടെ വിവാഹക്കാരിയാകുമ്പോൾ നിങ്ങളുടെ പട്ടണത്തിലെ ഏറ്റവും പ്രധാനിയായ അസ്ട്രോളജറെ പോയി കാണുന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങളൊരു ഫണ്ടമെന്റലിസ്റ്റ് ആണ്. പുറമേ ഒരു റെവല്യൂഷണറി ആണെങ്കിലും നിങ്ങളുടെ മനസ്സിനകത്ത് ഒരു പക്ക ഓർത്തഡോക്സ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു മനുഷ്യനാണ് നിങ്ങളെന്ന് പറയാം. അതേപോലെ ദ ഫസ്റ്റ് ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഓഫ് post-Keynesians, they are called as fundamentalist Keynesians. And the leaders are Robinson, Caldor, and others. Robinson calls mainstream Keynesians like Summerson, Hicks, Hanson, Tobin, Modigliani, and others as bastard Keynesians. ഇത് വളരെ വിവാദമുണ്ടാക്കിയ ഒരു പ്രയോഗമാണ്. സാമുവേൾസൺ ഇൻകം എക്സ്പെൻഡിച്ചർ മോഡൽ ഡെവലപ്പ് ചെയ്ത സാമുവേൾസനെയും ഐ എസ് എൽ എം മോഡൽ, കെയ്ൻസിന്റെ വിശദീകരണത്തിന് വേണ്ടി ഐ എസ് എൽ എം മോഡൽ ഉണ്ടാക്കിയ ഹിക്സിനെയും ആൻസനെയും മറ്റുള്ളവരെ എല്ലാരെയും, ആ ജനസിൽ പെടുന്ന എല്ലാരെയും ബാസ്റ്റാർഡ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻസ് എന്ന പദം കൊണ്ടാണ് റോബിൻസൺ വിശേഷിപ്പിക്കുന്നത്. കാരണം ഞാൻ നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ കെയ്ൻസ്, കേംബ്രിഡ്ജ് സർക്കസിലുണ്ടായിരുന്ന കെയ്ൻസിന്റെ, കെയ്ൻസുമായി നേരിട്ട് ഇടപഴകിയ, കെയ്ൻസിന്റെ മനസ്സെന്താണെന്ന് അറിഞ്ഞ എക്കോണമിസ്റ്റ് ആണ് റോബിൻസണും കാൽഡോറും കാനും മറ്റുള്ളവരും. അപ്പൊ അവരവകാശപ്പെടുന്ന അവരാണ് കെയ്ൻസിന്റെ യഥാർത്ഥ ശിഷ്യന്മാർ. മറ്റുള്ളവരൊക്കെ ബാസ്റ്റാർഡ് കെയ്നീഷ്യനിസം ആണ് പ്രചരിപ്പിക്കുന്നതെന്നാണ്. ഫണ്ടമെന്റലിസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ വ്യൂസ്, നമ്പർ വൺ, according to Keynes, or according to Keynes, there are three classical axioms. Paul Davidson argues that Keynes identified three crucial axioms of classical theory. Keynes in their prior pragaram, classical theory il moonu axioms kaanam ennaanu Davidson parayunnu. First one is the axiom of ergodicity, E-R-G-O-D-I-C-I-T-Y. What is it? The future can be reliably inferred from the past. Second is the axiom of gross substitution. That is, price flexibility ensures that all markets clear. And third is the neutrality of money axiom. It includes classical dichotomy, then homogeneity postulates, etc., etc. Money affects only the absolute price level and it will not affect the output and employment, and output and employment depends upon real factors like tastes and technology. So these were the three classical axioms as found by Keynes. Then Keynes believed all axioms to be wrong. See, next slide. Keynes argued that, or Keynes believed that, all these axioms are wrong because they, in a modern mature capitalist economy, there is non-ergodicity. We live in a non-ergodic world. That means future cannot be reliably inferred from the past. PG students, adaptive expectations theory, rational expectations theory, പരിശോധിക്കുക. ഈ രണ്ട് ഹൈപ്പോത്തസിസുകളിൽ എന്താണ് പറയുന്നത്? മിൽട്ടൺ ഫ്രീഡ്മാൻ എറർ കറക്ഷനെ പറ്റി പറയുന്നു, പാസ്റ്റ് വിൽ ബി യൂസ്ഡ്, പാസ്റ്റ് ഇൻഫർമേഷൻ വിൽ ബി യൂസ്ഡ് ടു അറൈവ് അറ്റ് ഫ്യൂച്ചർ ഡിസിഷൻസ്. ലൂക്കാസ് ആൻഡ് സാർജൻ, ദേ സേ ദാറ്റ് past, present, all informations will be processed to arrive at rational decision making. But Keynes rejected this assumption. Keynes insisted that, or he upheld the feature that we live in a non-ergodic world where future cannot be reliably inferred from the past. Second, the axiom of gross substitution inclusion is false. So that price flexibility does not guarantee full employment. Substitution is not possible. Price flexibility is not practicable. There will be price inflexibility, downward wage price inflexibility. And the third one, money is non-neutral. Money affects output and employment. So these are the major aspects of the first group of economists and their views. Then next slide. Next slide. Now I am skipping the next two slides, slide two and slide three, to save time. I am directly moving to the next viewpoint. Samayam laabhikkan vendi njan aa second slide lekum third slide lekum povunnilla. Moonamathe slide lekku varukayanu. Moonamathe slide il nammala post Keynesians inde randamathe pradhanapetta viewpoint kaanum. And that is the Kalaskian viewpoint. The great Polish economist Michael Kalaski discovered the principle of effective demand separately. Simultaneously or separately, he arrived at the same principle of effective demand. What modification he gave for that argument? He tested it with the Marxian theory. And he used a class framework. He used the classification of the social strata into workers and capitalists. Capitalist expenditure, according to him, is the key to business cycle. And workers spend what they get, and capitalists get what they spend. And Kalaski's algebra is derived from a very simple function. What is it? C plus I in the Keynesian equation will be equal to Cw plus Cp plus I. Keynesian equation le Ca Kalaski randayittu verthirikkunu endokkeyana Cw consumption out of wages and Cp consumption out of profit, and the other one is I. So C plus I becomes Cw plus Cp plus I, and income, total income, is equal to W plus P. That means national income is divided into wages plus profit. Now next na adutha slide kaanichal mathram mari. I am skipping those slides. I have given some simple algebra of his model, and you can copy this algebra after the class. Now the last one, profit share, according to before that. Yes. See, therefore, Kalaski argued that the profit share of the capitalist depends upon the degree of monopoly. Share of profits in the national income depends upon the degree of a monopoly. And in this slide, you can see that sound finance is always advocated by the supporters of the free market economy. Now there is another name for this argument. Austerity. In a capitalist society, ruling class will always support only austerity principle. ഇപ്പോൾ കോവിഡ് എന്ന ലോകം മുഴുവനും പടർന്നു പിടിക്കുന്ന ഈ രോഗാവസ്ഥയുള്ളപ്പോൾ പോലും ഓസ്റ്റെരിറ്റി വേണമെന്നാണ് പല മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീം ഇക്കോണമിസ്റ്റുകളും പറയുന്നത്. നമ്മുടെ ഇവിടെ നടന്ന ആന്റി കോവിഡ് ആത്മനിർഭർ പ്രോഗ്രാം ഒക്കെ നോക്കിയാൽ ഏകദേശം ഇതേ ആർഗ്യുമെന്റ് ആണ്. ഗവൺമെന്റിന്റെ എക്സ്പെൻഡിച്ചർ കൂട്ടാതെയുള്ള ചില ആന്റി കോവിഡ് പ്രോഗ്രാംസ് ആണ് ഇവിടെ നടപ്പിലാക്കിയത്. സോ സൗണ്ട് ഫിനാൻസ്. And they fear full employment because they fear that full employment will create a threat to the discipline in the factories. And they support military Keynesianism. Why? Because armament expenditure is less objectionable to the capitalist than civilian spending. Our sentence is armaments expenditure is less objectionable to the capitalist than civilian spending. So they support military Keynesianism and it is politically acceptable, but high wages and welfare states, they will not support. The capitalist ruling class will not support a welfare society. Next one. Next slide. Now here we introduce the third viewpoint, that is Minsky's viewpoint. It is called as the Wall Street vision of capitalism because Minsky was a prominent American economist explaining financial instability under capitalism. And during when Minsky introduced the financial instability hypothesis, nobody noticed it. And what happened during 2008, because of the housing bubble, most of the capitalist economies were in crisis, and even the mainstream economies, they referred to a situation called as the Minsky moment. Minsky moment ennoru padam upayogikkan mainstream economistukal vare gathi illade oru avasaram undayi. Minsky moment ennu parayunnathu endanu nammude malayalathil maaliga mugaleriya mannante tholil maarappu ketti ഭവാൻ എന്ന് ജാരപ്പാനയിൽ പറയുന്ന പോലെ അതീവ സമ്പന്നരായിട്ടുള്ള അമേരിക്ക പോലെയുള്ള രാജ്യങ്ങൾ പെട്ടെന്ന് എങ്ങനെയാണ് ഒരു ക്രൈസിസിൽപ്പെട്ട് താഴേക്ക് നിലം പതിക്കുന്നത്. ആ മോമെന്റിനെയാണ് മിൻസ്കി മോമെന്റ് എന്ന് വിളിക്കാൻ അവർ ബാധ്യസ്ഥരായത്. പക്ഷെ മിൻസ്കി അദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ തിയറീസ് ഒക്കെ ഉണ്ടാക്കിയ സമയത്ത് ആരും തന്നെ ഇതിന് ഒരു ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസും കൊടുത്തില്ല. അതുപോലെ തന്നെ നമ്മുടെ മാങ്കിയുടെ ഉൾപ്പെടെയുള്ള പുസ്തകങ്ങളിലൊന്നും മിൻസ്കി മൂവ്മെന്റ് കാണാൻ പറ്റില്ല. വൺസ് ഐ സെൻഡ് ആൻ ഇമെയിൽ ടു പ്രൊഫസർ മാങ്കി, ദെൻ ഹി കാഷ്വലി, ഓ ദാറ്റ് ഫെലോ ഹാസ് ഡെവലപ്ഡ് ദാറ്റ് ഇൻസ്റ്റെബിലിറ്റി ഹൈപ്പോസ് എന്നിങ്ങനെ കാഷ്വൽ ആയിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞു ഒഴിഞ്ഞല്ലാതെ അതിനെ പറ്റി കൂടുതലൊന്നും വിശദീകരണം നൽകിയില്ല. നെക്സ്റ്റ് സ്ലൈഡ്. ഈ സ്ലൈഡിൽ മിൻസ്കിയുടെ മെയിൻ ആർഗ്യുമെന്റ്സ് കാണും. മിൻസ്കി ഹാസ് ഡിസ്റ്റിങ്വിഷ്ഡ് ത്രീ ഫേസസ്. ഫസ്റ്റ് വൺ ഈസ് ഹെഡ്ജ് ഫിനാൻസ്. വട്ട് ഈസ് ഇറ്റ്? ഇൻ ദി ഏർലി സ്റ്റേജസ് ഓഫ് എ ബിസിനസ് സൈക്കിൾ, ദെൻ ലെൻഡേഴ്സ് അക്കോമഡേറ്റ് ദോസ് ബോറോവേഴ്സ് ഹൂസ് പ്രോജക്ട്സ് ആർ എക്സ്പെക്ടഡ് ടു സഫീഷ്യന്റ്ലി പ്രോഫിറ്റബിൾ ടു അലോ ദം ടു മേക്ക് interest payments as well as the principal. Speculative finance means where lenders are less cautious and they no longer require the repayment and only principal is guaranteed. And the third one is the most dangerous situation that world underwent during 2008. 2008 il loka sambanna rajyangal kadannu poya situation aanu പത്തൊമ്പതാം നൂറ്റാണ്ടിലിന്റെ അവസാനവും ഇരുപതാം നൂറ്റാണ്ടിന്റെ ഇറ്റലിയിൽ ജീവിച്ചിരുന്ന ഒരു വലിയ തട്ടിപ്പുകാരനായിരുന്നു പോൺസി. ആ തട്ടിപ്പുകാരന്റെ പേരാണ് പോൺസി. ഇങ്ങനെ തട്ടിപ്പ് നടത്തുന്ന ഫിനാൻഷ്യൽ ഓപ്പറേഷനെ പിന്നീട് ഫിനാൻഷ്യൽ ലിറ്ററേച്ചറിൽ പോൺസി ഫിനാൻസ് എന്ന് വിളിക്കാൻ തുടങ്ങി. So third one is Ponzi finance. What is the feature? Where lending standards become so lax that some borrowers need to take out of other loans to meet their interest. കടം വാങ്ങിയത് തിരിച്ചു കൊടുക്കാൻ വീണ്ടും കടം വാങ്ങുന്ന അപകടകരമായ ഒരു അവസ്ഥ, അതിനെയാണ് Ponzi finance എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. And according to Minsky, there are three situations and a capitalist economy can at any time directly into the third situation, Ponzi finance situation. The next slide. Next one. Now, ഇതില് നിന്ന് എന്ത് മനസ്സിലാക്കാം? See, during Minsky's lifetime, no great depression or recession took place. Why? Because government expenditure was much higher and built-in stabilizers, as in general theory, was very active during the downturn, and therefore no recession took place. And the budget deficit since 1929 in America provided private sector a huge quantity of risk-free government security and liquidity. And therefore, financial stability was there. But during 2008, everything collapsed and the world witnessed a Ponzi financial crisis. And Minsky also developed a concept named money manager capitalism. I am skipping that point. Next slide. Now we shall wind up our discussion by touching the major themes of post-Keynesian themes. As I said, this is a repetition. Accumulation of capital, determination of value, discrimination of distributed shares into profits and wages, economic growth, measurement of capital, endogenous money supply, markup pricing, animal spirits, investment and employment, expectations and uncertainty, microeconomics of aggregate supply and the aggregate demand, non-existence of natural rate of unemployment, financial instability, sectoral balance, non-linear dynamic models. Don't think that post-Keynesian macroeconomics is mathematics free. They don't advocate too much mathematics, but they do use mathematical models, especially non-linear dynamic models. And in environmental economics, they apply precautionary principle. Rio meeting il vecha avadharikkapetta pala principlesil 10 principlesil oru principle aya precautionary principle adinte adisthanam post Keynesian environmental economics branch aanu applied to sustainable development, etc. List a few from the old and new post Keynesian literature. Now we can conclude. Next. Conclusions. Now there is a short form called as TINA. Accepted short form. What is TINA? TINA. എന്നാൽ നമ്മൾ വളരെ പോപ്പുലർ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു പേരാണ്. നിങ്ങളുടെ തന്നെ സുഹൃത്തുക്കളുടെ പേര് ടീന എന്ന് കാണും. പക്ഷെ ടീന എന്നത് ഒരു ഷോർട്ട് ഫോമായാണ് ഇവിടെ ഉപയോഗിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നത്. എന്താണ് ടീന? There is no alternative എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ എന്താ? മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീം ഇക്കോണമീസ് ആർഗ്യൂ ദാറ്റ് there is no alternative except austerity policies and low wage policies even during a financial crisis period. 2008 le pole ulla oru financial crisis inde samayathu polum austerity policies um low wage policies um aanu nadappilakkanda, and there is no other alternative. Tina ennaanu avaru parayum. This is the dominant view held by mainstream economists belonging to new classical and also mainstream Keynesian economists, like new Keynesians. On the other hand, there are those who say that there is an alternative. Who are they? They are the post-Keynesian dissent. They are the dissenters inside the mainstream school, like Joseph Stiglitz. Mainstream economists now to enable still a dissenters undayirunnu. Dissenters nu parayan da ഈ അടുത്ത കാലത്തെ ഒരു പാർട്ടിയിലെ സംഭവ വികാസം കാരണം ആ പാർട്ടിക്ക് അകത്ത് തന്നെ ഡിസെൻഡിങ് വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ് ഉണ്ടായിട്ടുണ്ട് എന്ന് ചില പത്രങ്ങളും മീഡിയകളും ഈ അടുത്ത കാലത്ത് രണ്ടു ദിവസം മുമ്പ് പറയുണ്ടായി. ഒരു വളരെ പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട രാഷ്ട്രീയ പാർട്ടിയുടെ ഉള്ളിലുണ്ടായ സംഭവ വികാസം കാരണം അതിനകത്ത് തന്നെ ഒരു ഡിസെൻഡിങ് വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ് ഉണ്ടായിട്ടുണ്ട്, ചിലർ ഉണ്ടായിട്ടുണ്ടെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട്. അതേപോലെ മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീം new Keynesian economist ആണ് ജോസഫ് സ്റ്റിഗ്ലിറ്റ്സ്. But He is a dissenter. So on the other hand, there are those who say that there is an alternative. They are orthodox dissenters. Adugondana very orthodox dissenters norena. Like Joseph Stiglitz, George Akerlof. Akerlof in the pair njana ivide vechittla Akerlofum Schillerum koodi. Schiller aanu thonu rendu verum koodi Animal Spirits enna oru pustham ezhuthittundu. And on the other hand, the post-Keynesian macroeconomics. Then I shall conclude the session by quoting from Professor Mark Lavoie. Mark Lavoie is a modern post-Keynesian economist, and he is a sportsman also. Nammude Olympicsil pangeduthittulla oru sportsman koodiyana Professor Mark Lavoie. അദ്ദേഹം ഇന്ന് ജീവിച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന ഏറ്റവും പ്രധാനിയായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു മോഡേൺ പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ മാക്രോ ഇക്കോണമിസ്റ്റ് ആണ്. മാത്തമാറ്റിക്കൽ എക്കോണമിസ്റ്റ്, എക്കണോമെട്രീഷ്യൻ. ലെറ്റ് മീ കൺക്ലൂഡ് ടുഡേസ് ഡിസ്കഷൻ ബൈ കോട്ടിംഗ് ഫ്രം പ്രൊഫസർ മാർക്ക് ലവോയി. ഹി സ്റ്റേറ്റ്സ് ദാറ്റ് പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് ഇസ് ആൻ ആന്റി ഡോട്ട് ടു ടീന, ടു ദി ആർഗ്യുമെന്റ് ദാറ്റ് ദർ ഈസ് നോ അതർ ആൾട്ടർനേറ്റീവ്. It is much more than a critique of mainstream economics. It provides realistic foundations for proposals of feasible alternative policies. Now, this is in brief the sum and substance of the post-Keynesian macroeconomics. Post-Keynesian macroeconomics agathamaya sagaramana. ഇതിന്റെ എല്ലാ തിയറികളെയും പരാമർശിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് ഒരു ഒരു കോഴ്സ് തന്നെ നമ്മുടെ ഈ പുതിയ ഹെറ്ററോഡോക്സ് പേപ്പറിനകത്ത് അത് മുഴുവൻ ഉൾപ്പെടുത്തി കാണുമെന്നാണ് എൻ്റെ വിശ്വാസം. അത് മുഴുവനും കവർ ചെയ്യാൻ അമാനുഷികമായിട്ടുള്ള കാര്യമാണ്. അനേക ദിവസങ്ങൾ കൊണ്ടേ കവർ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റൂ. അതുകൊണ്ട് അതിൽ നിന്ന് ഒരു ഏകദേശ ഡിസ്ക്രിപ്ഷൻ മാത്രമാണ് നൽകിയത്. മെനി ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻറ്റ് ബുക്സ്, സി ടു ഫോട്ടോഗ്രാഫ്സ്, ഫോട്ടോഗ്രാഫ് ഓഫ് ജോൺ മെനാർഡ് കെയ്ൻസ്, ദ വെരി ടോൾ ഇക്കോണമിസ്റ്റ്. And his wife. See, during 1926, he fell into love with a Russian ballet dancer, Lydia Lopakova. She was a Russian ballet dancer. Avarude padamana ittirikkuna, and they have no children. So, I shall mention some the names of titles of some useful textbooks. ഗൂഗിളിൽ പോയി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ യു വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് മെനി ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ബുക്സ്, ബട്ട് ടു ബുക്സ് ആർ വെരി വെരി ഇൻഫോർമേറ്റീവ്. നമ്പർ വൺ, എ ഹിസ്റ്ററി ഓഫ് പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ്, എ ഹിസ്റ്ററി ഓഫ് പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് ബൈ ജെ ഇ കിങ്, കെ എൻ ജി, ഐ എൻ ജി, ജെ ഇ കിങ്, പബ്ലിഷ്ഡ് ബൈ Edward Elgar. A History of Post-Keynesian Economics. J. E. King is the author. Edward Elgar, publisher. Idu Google-il ninnu download cheyyam free aayi. Second, Structure of Post-Keynesian School. Structure of Post-Keynesian School. PKS nittu kanyal eluppundu. The core contributions, the core core, core contributions of the pioneers. P-I-O-N-E-E-R-S. P-I-O-N-E-E-R-S. The core contributions of the pioneers by G.C. G.C. Harcourt. H-A-R-C-O-U-R-T. H-A-R-C-O-U-R-T, a prominent post-Keynesian, G.C. Harcourt, published by Cambridge University Press, CUP, Cambridge University Press, 2006. Then, if you want post-Keynesian econometrics, post-Keynesian econometrics, padikkanam undengil, there are two volumes titled Post-Keynesian Econometrics, Post-Keynesian Econometrics, Microeconomics and a theory of the firm. Post Keynesian econometrics, microeconomics and the theory of the firm. Beyond the Keynes. Volume 1 and 2, edited by Sheila Doe. Sheila Doe. Sheila Doe is a prominent post-Keynesian. Sheila Doe and John Hillard, H-I-L-L-A-R-D. John Hillard. Then an introduction to post-Keynesian. Price theory, not introduction, post-Keynesian price theory. Post-Keynesian microeconomics, post-Keynesian price theory in the book. By Frederick, F-R-E-D-E-R-I-C, Frederick S. Lee, L-E-E. Frederick, F-R-E-D-E-R-I-C, Frederick S. Lee, L-E-E. Published by Cambridge University Press, CUP. Published by Cambridge University Press, 2003. ഇതെല്ലാം സ്പെഷ്യലൈസ്ഡ് ബുക്സ് ആണ്. ദീസ് ആർ സ്പെഷ്യലൈസ്ഡ് ബുക്സ്. ഇതൊന്നും വേണ്ട, ഒരു ജനറൽ റീഡിംഗ് ആണ് വേണ്ടതെന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ യു റെഫർ ദ ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ബുക്ക് മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് ബൈ ജെയിംസ് ഗാൽബ്രൈറ്റ് ആൻഡ് വില്യം ഡാരിറ്റി. ഈ സ്പെഷ്യലൈസ്ഡ് ബുക്കൊന്നും വേണ്ട, ഒരു ഒഴുക്കൻ മട്ടിലുള്ള പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് ആണ് വായിക്കാൻ ഇഷ്ടമെങ്കിൽ മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് എന്ന ടൈറ്റിലുള്ള ജെയിംസ് ഗാൽബ്രൈറ്റ്, ജോൺ കെന്നത് ഗാൽബ്രൈറ്റിന്റെ മകനാണ് ജെയിംസ് ഗാൽബ്രൈറ്റ്, പ്രൊഫസർ ജെയിംസ് ഗാൽബ്രൈറ്റ് ആൻഡ് വില്യം WILLIAM വില്യം ഡാരിറ്റി DARITY. അവരെ പബ്ലിഷ് ചെയ്ത മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് എന്ന ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ബുക്ക് ഗൂഗിളിൽ നിന്ന് ഫ്രീ ആയി ഡൗൺലോഡ് ചെയ്യാം. ആൻഡ് വൺ ചാപ്റ്റർ ഈസ് എക്സ്ക്ലൂസീവ്ലി ഓൺ ദി സമ്മറി ഓഫ് പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ്. ആൻഡ് ദർ ഈസ് അൻ ആഡഡ് അഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ്, ഇറ്റ് ഗിവ്സ് ഡീറ്റെയിൽഡ് എക്സ്പ്ലനേഷൻ ഓഫ് മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീം മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് ഓൾസോ. ആ ബുക്ക് ഡൗൺലോഡ് ചെയ്താൽ ഒരു വേടിക്ക് രണ്ട് പക്ഷി എന്ന് പറയുന്ന പോലെ മെയിൻ സ്ട്രീം മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ് മുഴുവനും കവർ ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. അതേപോലെ തന്നെ പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻ മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സിന്റെ ഔട്ട്ലൈൻ കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ആയിരുന്നു. ദെൻ യുവർ ഫെമിലിയർ ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ബ്രിയാൻ സ്നോഡോൺ ആൻഡ് ഹോവാർഡ് വെയ്ൽ, മോഡേൺ മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സ്. സോ വൺസ് അഗൈൻ ലെറ്റ് മീ താങ്ക് ദി ഓർഗനൈസേഴ്സ് ആൻഡ് ഐ ആം വെരി മച്ച് ഇൻഡെബ്റ്റഡ് ടു പ്രൊഫസർ പ്രസാദ് ആൻഡ് പ്രൊഫസർ രാജി രാമകൃഷ്ണൻ ഫോർ ആൻഡ് പ്രൊഫസർ ഡോക്ടർ ശ്രീജ മാഡം ടീച്ചേഴ്സ് ഫോർ ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റി. താങ്ക് യു. പ്ലീസ് ആസ്ക് മീ നൗ.
താങ്ക് യു സോ മച്ച് സാർ, ഇറ്റ് വാസ് സച്ച് എൻ ഇൻഫോർമേറ്റീവ് ടോക്ക്. ഇഫ് എനിവൺ ഹാവ് ടു ആസ്ക് എനി ടൈപ്പ് ഓഫ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ്, ജസ്റ്റ് സെൻഡ് മീ ഇൻ ദ ചാറ്റ് ബോക്സ്, സോ യു ക്യാൻ ഡയറക്ട്ലി ആസ്ക് ടു സർ ബൈ അൺമ്യൂട്ടിംഗ് യുവർ മൈക്രോഫോൺസ്. Questions in the chat box. So if anybody have any type of doubts or something, you can just ask directly to the sir by muting your microphones. A question is that what is the main difference in argument between post Keynesians and new Keynesians?
See, that is obvious. New Keynesians, they are a part of mainstream Keynesians, is it not so? They accept rational expectation assumption. And they assume perfect foresight. And they believe that Keynesian rigidity in wages and prices is only a short-run situation. And they believe that monetary policy, on the lines of the new classical macroeconomists, they assume that monetary policy is much more effective than the fiscal policy. And they have used the logical time analysis. Finally, they believe that in the long run, through appropriate monetary policy, see, you might have heard about the Taylor's rule. All over the world, most of the central banks, they have now accepted interest rate targeting. Target the very, very short period or overnight interest rates. One can stabilize the economy. And the rate should be equivalent to, for example, the repo rate and reverse repo rate should be equal to the general rule framed by Professor John D. Taylor rule. Now, the new Keynesians, they accept all these. They join the and arrive at the same consensus. It is called as the neoclassical consensus number 2. We know the earlier neoclassical, what is the consensus? Samuelson and Hicks and others, they say that in the short run, the economy will experience Keynesian rigidity, but in the long run, the economy will go back to the classical full employment situation. So it was a compromise between acceptable to Keynesians and classicals. Now, new Keynesians, new classicals, and until they have developed a separate theory. നമ്മുടെ പുസ്തകങ്ങളിലൊന്നും അത് ചില പുസ്തകങ്ങളിൽ മാത്രമേ എത്തി തുടങ്ങിയിട്ടുള്ളൂ. ആൻഡ് ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് കോൾഡ് ആസ് ദി സെക്കൻഡ് ന്യൂ ക്ലാസിക്കൽ സിന്തസിസ് ബേസ്ഡ് അപ്പോൺ ടെയ്ലേഴ്സ് റൂൾ ആൻഡ് ഇന്ററസ്റ്റ് റേറ്റ് ടാർഗറ്റിംഗ് ഓവർവെൽമിംഗ് റോൾ ഓഫ് മോണിറ്ററി പോളിസി സൈലൻസ് ഓഫ് ഫിസ്കൽ പോളിസി ഓസ്റ്ററിറ്റി. സോ ദേർഫോർ ദെർ ഈസ് ക്ലിയർ കട്ട് ഡിഫറൻസ് ബിറ്റ്വീൻ ന്യൂ കെയ്നീഷ്യൻസ് ആൻഡ് പോസ്റ്റ് കെയ്നീഷ്യൻസ്. New Keynesians, Mankey says that their Keynesianism is reincarnated Keynesianism. Punarjanicha Keynesianism. But in effect, it is nothing but mainstream explanation. Mainstream. See, it will be better if you get the early edition, 1948 or 1958 edition of Samuelson's Economist textbook. ഇന്നും നമ്മൾ ഡിഗ്രിക്ക് പഠിച്ചു തുടങ്ങുന്ന മാക്രോ ഇക്കണോമിക്സിന്റെ ബേസിക് ഫോം എങ്ങനെയാണ്? സാമുവൽസന്റെ ആ ഡയഗ്രാം തന്നെയാണ് കോപ്പി ചെയ്തിരിക്കുന്നത്. കെയ്ൻസ് ഡിഡ് നോട്ട് യൂസ് ദോസ് ഡയഗ്രാംസ്. ഹി എക്സ്പ്ലെയിൻസ് കൺസംപ്ഷൻ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെന്റ് ഫംഗ്ഷൻ ആഗ്രഗേറ്റ് ഡിമാൻഡ് 45 line equilibrium, then inflationary gap, deflationary gap, multiplier, accelerator, then fiscal policy, investment, say all these, the entire framework was developed by Samuelson. And he is sometimes called as classical Keynesian. That is classical, K-N-A. Instead of the letter C, we use K-L-A. Classical Keynesianism means he use the classical framework to explain Keynesian, and it is an absurd approach. Even Professor Clover and Lejon Wood, they say that it is an absurd approach. They wrongly applied a Valrasian framework to explain a revolutionary idea of Menarchies. So that in most libraries, that book is available. Early edition of Samuelson's book.
Okay.
You will get the that diagram also. Bathtub diagram where you will get the hydraulic Keynesianism. Yes.
Yeah, so another question is, what is the heterodox view of modern monetary regime?
Modern?
What is the heterodox view of modern monetary regime?
See, ഈ സമയക്കുറവ് കാരണം ഒരു കാര്യം പറയാൻ വിട്ടു. എല്ലാം ഉൾപ്പെടുത്താൻ പറ്റിയിട്ടില്ല. വിൻ ഗോഡ്ലി, പ്രൊഫസർ വിൻ ഗോഡ്ലി, he was a professor as well as an advisor to UK government. He was a member of another group of post-Keynesians, early post-Keynesians, called as New Cambridge Macroeconomists. Robinson-ന്റെ അവരുമായിട്ട് ബന്ധമുണ്ടെങ്കിലും വേറെ ഒരു ഗ്രൂപ്പായി പോകും. ആൻഡ് ഹി ഹാസ് ഡെവലപ്ഡ് സെക്ടോറൽ ബാലൻസ് മോഡൽ. നമ്മുടെ മെയിൻസ്ട്രീം ബുക്കിൽ ഒന്നും കാണാൻ പറ്റില്ല, സെക്ടോറൽ ബാലൻസ് മോഡൽ. ആൻഡ് എ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഓഫ് മോഡേൺ പോസ്കൈനീഷ്യൻസ് ലൈക്ക് സ്റ്റെഫാനി കെൽട്ടൺ, ഒരു ലേഡിയാണ് സ്റ്റെഫാനി കെൽട്ടൺ, പ്രൊഫസർ സ്റ്റെഫാനി കെൽട്ടൺ, and certain other economists, they have developed a branch of monetary theory called as modern monetary theory, MMT. And they say that money supply can play a very, very important role in providing stability in the economy. And it is a highly controversial one. And it is a part of post-Keynesian macroeconomics.
Okay, so another question, do you consider that current approach of post-Keynesians fits with the original proposal of John Robinson and the Cambridge Circus Academy group?
Can we make it more clear?
Do you consider that current approach of post-Keynesians fits with the original proposal of John Robinson and the Cambridge Academic group?
Sure. They are the grandchildren. Current generation of post-Keynesians, Mark Levoy, J.E. King, Harcourt. Harcourt is not a young, he was a colleague of Robinson. All modern post-Keynesians, they are the grandchildren of the founding fathers, Robinson, Caldor, Robinson, and others. And there are post-Kaleskian economists, post-Straffa, Anglo-Italian economists, and there are many other people. Their basic ideas are the same. ഞാൻ ആദ്യം പറഞ്ഞ ആ കോർ പ്രിൻസിപ്പിൾസും അതുപോലെ തന്നെ അതിനു മുമ്പ് പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുള്ള ടു വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ്സും അതിൽ അവർ ഉറച്ചു
നിൽക്കുന്നവരാണ്.
Depending upon the nature of the economy, they support or they have prepared their own modifications. Keynes jeevichirunna aa kalagattathile aa oru second world war, first world war, second world war aa samayam great depression adil ninnu valare maatangal ulla oru oru economy aanu alle all Keynes inde aa basic proposal ne adisaranapaduthikonde these people they have developed several policy alternatives. നമ്മുടെ പിന്നെ പോൾ ഡേവിഡ്സന്റെ ലേറ്റസ്റ്റ് ബുക്കുകൾ നോക്കി ചിലതെല്ലാം ഡൗൺലോഡ് ചെയ്യാം. അതിനകത്ത് മറ്റുള്ളവരുടെ നോക്കി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ പോളിസി പ്രപ്പോസൽസ് ടോട്ടലി നെഗ്ലക്ട് ദീസ് മീൻസ്. 2008 പോലും മാങ്കിയുടെ ബുക്കിൽ പോലും മിൻസ്കിയുടെ പേരില്ല എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ആയിസന്റെ മെയിൽ ഞാൻ നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ ടു മാങ്കി ബാങ്കി ഇങ്ങനെ വെറുതെ ഒരു ക്യാഷ് ലോ ദാറ്റ് ഫെല്ലോ ഇങ്ങനെ തന്നെയാണ് അദ്ദേഹം ദാറ്റ് ഫെല്ലോ ഇങ്ങനെ ഇമ്പോർട്ടന്റ് ആയിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞത് ഒഴുക്കാൻ പറ്റിയൊരു സോ ഇൻ ബ്രീഫ് മിൽട്ടൺ ഫ്രീഡ്മാൻ ഈസ് കൺസിഡേർഡ് ആസ് ദി ഗോഡ് ഫാദർ ഓഫ് ന്യൂ കെയ്നീഷ്യൻസ് ഓൾസോ കാരണം അവരെ പലരെയും ട്രെയിൻ ചെയ്ത മിൽട്ടൺ ഫ്രീഡ്മാൻ തന്നെ. And the most modern post-Keynesians, they have developed complex econometrics and mathematical models. Any other questions?
If anyone wants to ask questions directly, then you can ask directly. Okay, so no one is asking. Okay, I think it's our end of our session. Thank you so much, sir, for joining with us. It was a pleasure to be with you and to hear your class. Thank you so, so much. You have given your valuable time for us. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you is the best prayer that anyone could say. So I welcome Agil Krishna of MIT Economics for the word of thanks.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible again. Thank you.
Respected resource person of the day, Dr. G. Vishak Verma, sir, Dr. Srijam, ma'am, and all other dignitaries, a very warm good evening to all. My duty to here is to express word of thanks to you all. Firstly, I express my sincere thanks to Dr. G. Vishak Verma, sir, today's resource person, had given a very fruitful and informative session on post-Keynesian economics in very interesting manner. On behalf of PG Department of Economics and all those who have gathered here, and on my own behalf, I express my heartfelt thanks to sir. I express my sincere thanks to senior teacher, HOD, PG Department of Economics for initiating such an effort to conducting this webinar. Prasad sir, the organizer of webinar, chooses a very relevant topic for this discussion. I also express my sincere thanks to you, sir. Plus, thanks to Alia Nasrin for successful moderating this session. I also express my heartfelt thanks to all teachers and students for your great support and coordination. Once again, thank you all. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Ajit. Thank you, sir, for joining with us. It was a great time. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. So tomorrow our session will be continued on the topic Introduction to Heterodox Economics. I invite all your presence. The candidates can leave now after filling their feedback form in order to ensure your attendance. So thank you all. Thank you so much. Have a nice day. The participants can now leave the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.